Tomomi, good morning. It is so cold outside.
One, two, three.
Thanks to all of you for, well, wasting away a beautiful and sunny afternoon in Lund in this venue, which is called after the man himself. Now, let me start this account with Leif. Leif is a person unbeknownst to you, a 72-year-old farmer from the municipality of Markaryd in Sweden, in southern Sweden. Some month ago, I spent a week with him at Lund University Hospital, where we both successfully underwent surgery. We spent a week together in total, 6 days I think it was, in a 4-bed ward at the neurosurgical department on the 11th floor of the central building of the university hospital here, and also a 48-hour cycle in the operation theater itself and in the intensive care unit. So I learned quite something about Leif, and I also learned something from Leif. Leif suffers from Parkinson's disease, it should be said. On Monday that week we spent together. The surgical team implanted two probes. Probes are metal rods of, well, some centimeters length, which are very thin. Probably don't want to hear it, I'm telling you anyway. They implanted these probes in Leif's brains. And I should also tell you that a lot of people, being in the area of neuroscience and the law, they're saying it's such a great topic because you can show all these great pictures. So you should be thankful that I'm not showing you all these great pictures. Anyway, Leif was implanted these probes into his brain, two, one on the left and one on the right side. They were connected with subcutaneous wiring running on the back of his head and his neck, two of kind of pacemaker are placed in Leif's chest. All this is under the skin, so you wouldn't see it apart from the lesions resulting from the surgery. Now, this is a complicated and demanding operation, both for the person exposed to it and obviously for the surgeons. So Leif was spending the better part of that first day together in surgery. And he was very exhausted when he came in and joined me in the intensive care unit, where we both were supposed to wake up and improve and all this kind of stuff. Now, what I should add here is that he was off his medicine due to the surgery, so I could observe the violence of the tremor, the Parkinson tremor, that imposed itself on his body. On Wednesday, upon return to our four-bed ward, a specialized nurse, let's call her Anna, came to see Leif and to turn on the pulse generator, the thing in his chest, with a small remote control, not too unlike the entertainment gadgetry which we are all wearing in everyday life, at least I assume that. Now, after rudimentary programming of the strength and the frequency of the electrical current, the electrical pulses in that generator, both Leif and Anna left the room. Leif shuffling forward with his rollator, supported by Anna, the nurse, who was holding him with one arm and holding the remote control in the other. Now, I had gone back into a dozing state of mind at this stage. It was, after all, only 1.5 days after my own surgery, and although I wasn't nearly playing in the same league when it came to the intensity of both the suffering and the recovery, I was quite tired. So I lived in one of these motorcycle magazines, which happened to be around in large numbers at neurosurgery wards, and you can draw your own conclusions on the clientele now, when suddenly a person burst into the room, stopped at an empty bed and described a kind of a perpendicular movement with his one leg. And Anna was rushing him after him, huffing and puffing, and saying, "Leif, I'm not quite content with your left turns." So, here we saw a kind of a transformed and pulse-generated Lazarus emerging from, a very serious condition under a very serious disease. Now, I was, of course, deeply impressed by that. Leif was dramatically improved compared with his pre-surgery state, and this lifted spirits with all occupants of that four-bed room. If they could fix Leif, they would fix anybody, it seemed. That said, I learned later that the technology used with Leif, deep brain stimulation, or DBS, is actually about the suppression of symptoms rather than the curing of diseases. So that's an important nuance. In short, the remote control, which Anna handed over to Leif at a later point, the remote control governs the strength and the frequency of the electrical impulses that are sent from the pacemaker to the probes in Leif's head. And there, the probes emit that current into a particular area of the brain. And in that particular area, they counteract the neuronal signals that are otherwise causing the tremor in Leif's legs. So what you get is that the electrical current from the pacemaker ultimately cancels out the tremor. Now, medically, it is not understood why this works, but it works. Now, in the coming days, Leif's improvement came out as a trade-off. While his movements were articulated, his speech was less so. It was increasingly hard to follow his brief comments during the lunch break and during lunch conversations. A fellow patient, well-versed in the literature on deep brain stimulation, informed me that this was normal and that the remote control could actually be used to temporarily turn off the electrical pulses, thereby improving the speech, but obviously at the price of the tremor returning. So you had some kind of a trade-off here, which in simple forms looks like this. You have a motoric function, that is control over your leg, this axis, and you have a linguistic function here, or control, which is allowing yourself to articulate yourself in a way that makes other people understand you. We could actually put down the title too, articulation, and the relation is something like that. It's a pretty clear-cut trade-off. If Leif is interested to move in an articulated fashion, to control the tremor over his legs, he should choose to actually maximize the current. And if he wants to talk to people, to be understood, to communicate with language, to express himself, he should actually accept that there be a certain tremor and deactivate the system or actually lower the current or the frequency of the currents. So that's the idea. Now, I returned home. I happened to read an article in The Guardian which reported on military researchers' experiments with neuroscience to augment the performance of one's own soldiers. And you see that I'm starting my talk only now. So The Guardian reported on another report by the Royal Society, a US scientific society, that had a larger study, four partial reports making up for one whole, and that one of these partial reports was actually relating how militaries wish to improve the performance of their own soldiers by using neuroscience, or to degrade the performance of enemy soldiers, also by neuroscience. And here was a richness of methodologies that were considered. I was really taken aback by the examples given. I'm just picking out two here. Weak currents induced into the brain as to improve a person's ability to detect IEDs, that is, wayside bombs, of the type they are used in Afghanistan. So you can actually get an improvement of the detection rate of such objects, of such dangerous objects, if you're stimulating the brain in a particular manner based on neuroscientific knowledge. Secondly, there was also considered a full integration of the human brain into a weapon system, and I'll get back to the rationale of doing that. Now, in that, I recognized the same class of neuroscience that was being used on Leif, and from which he had benefited so much, and it surprised me that I had not even thought about inverse applications of this type of empirical knowledge back at the hospital. I experienced personally a complete reversal of the enthusiasm triggered by Leif's liberation from his relator. The disenchantment was but the problem of dual use, a technology restituting life is potentially bought at the price of a technology delivering death, another trade-off. Now let me move on to the question, what are neuroweapons? They're part of the title of my talk today, and I should bring you a bit closer to understanding what I understand when using the term neuroweapons. But let's start with armament developments, because what I'm talking about is not real in the sense that you already have these weapon systems deployed, but it's real in the sense that you have a class of defense engineers developing these weapons not only since yesterday or this year or the year before, but actually since one or two decades, one could say. And there are considerable resources allocated to such developments. So armament development at large means transposing fantasies on the form conflict takes in the future. In following armament development with our own thinking, we may understand current beliefs on what it means to be a human being in that future. Now, in general, arms development follows a temporal logic of surprise, being first with the latest. If you look at the heading on the website of one of the main actors, the US agency DARPA, it reads, "Creating and Preventing Strategic Surprise." That is a kind of a self-understanding of the mission of that agency. Now, my main example of neuroscientific applications in the military domain is very literally about acceleration. In a great number of battlefield situations, the human brain is actually faster than a computer would be when it comes to perceiving threats. But a computer, on the other hand, is faster than a human being in calculating a response to a threat, in calculating a countermeasure, an engagement of the threat, or whatever. Obviously, those militaries which are able of to combine the two, the fastness of human perception and the fastness of machine calculation, will gain a temporal advantage over those who do not. As you will see, time competes with consciousness in whatever I will be saying in the following. Now, the first scenario. Putting a computer-aided weapon into the hands of a soldier is a kind of a rudimentary way of combining man and machine. You have a computer, it is in the weapon, it does things that you couldn't be doing, at least not in the same time without the computer, but you have still a clear idea that here is man and there is machine. So there's a separation here. Put that person into an urban warfare situation, which is complex, which is messy in a sense. In that first scenario, the soldier has to process the information gathered from perception into what we tend to cast as a conscious decision on what to do. Should I engage the target? Should I not engage the target? What is the target in the first place? What is the person I happen to be seeing in that window? Is that a friend or is that a foe? Is that a combatant or is that a civilian, a person protected by international humanitarian law? Those are questions of status, and ultimately they are questions of status recognition. So I would like us all to split up our thinking about this in two steps. One about cognition, which is a first step, and a step which might seem to be iterative, that is a kind of a repetition, but I think it adds something, which is recognition. So here language actually plays in our hands by allowing us, at least in the English language, the privilege of the word recognition with its re-signaling some kind of an iteration. I think it's important because it allows us to think that this iteration is something which moves us into the conscious domain. Now, ideally, the decision the soldier takes will be prone at least to reconstruction and justification in language. So this is this first scenario. I think we still need it, so I'll make a very bad sketch of what is going on here. Here you have a kind of a urban warfare situation with a building, various windows. Here is a person here, and here you have a soldier equipped with this weapon, which is somehow very advanced. And that person gets sight of the other person, and now there's a process of not only cognition but recognition. Is the sighting here, is that about a person who can be engaged, who can be attacked, who can be targeted, who can be killed, or is that sighting about a person who's protected? That could be one subject of the kind of cognitive, recognitive process going on here. Now, you will have seen the problem with this kind of rudimentary man-machine interface already. It costs time. If you go through consciousness, you need time. If you go through a full recognition process, you need time. Consider a second scenario now, in which we're moving from this kind of ground warfare to a military jet, one of the more, or perhaps the most, accelerated weapons we have in war fighting today. This is a very bad way of actually giving an idea of this jet. It's flying here at high altitude, and it's being engaged, as military parlance has it, by an anti-aircraft missile, which is flying here. Now, what you have today, both in the military and the civilian sector, are devices that you can mount on an airplane. I have no idea whether it's exactly here, but let's say it's sitting here, and there's a sensor built into it. In a sense, it has nothing to do with the pilot, and the sensor perceives the ultraviolet light emitted by the plume of this missile. So it registers that particular form of signal, the ultraviolet light, and automatically sends a signal to some other device, sending out decoys. You might have seen pictures of that. It's part of the kind of the visualization of the clean war. You have an airplane flying here. There are all kinds of almost decorative lights around it. And those are these decoys which the airplane just has released in order to defend itself against, for example, missiles. And now the missile will engage the decoys. Now, my point is actually that the decision-making is excluding the pilot. The pilot is not needed in order to process all that. And it's important to understand that here we have to do with a situation of utmost acceleration. Planes are very fast, missiles are very fast. In order to make up for that disadvantage, what you do is that you eliminate consciousness. You eliminate, in a sense, the recognition step. What you do is you equal cognition, that is the detection of the missile, with the decision to engage it. So there's no need for a separate process here. So that's the second scenario. And now the third scenario is finally about neuroscience, where I'm considering a scenario which is much written about in the literature today, where machine skills are integrated, where human skills are integrated into the machine skills rather than combined. So you no longer have a clear separation between a combatant and the weapons she or he is using, but you actually have a way of enmeshing the two into each other. Now, this is perhaps a bit difficult to visualize in a way you would recognize, but let me try to do it like this. This is a computer of some kind. And you are linking it up, starting the story with the computer. You're linking it up with a person who has some kind of a bathing cap with a lot of, probes on his head. So this is not the kind of LAFE-type surgery. You're just mounting an EEG device on the head of a person. That person is looking, for example, at a screen depicting a piece of territory in a conflict area where the challenge is to find out where there are targets, where there are enemy fighters, or where there are bombs or whatever. So you have this person here who's looking at the screen, and there's a neuronal activity going on. We're not interested in the conscious processes in the heads of that person, but we are interested in a particular readiness signal which is produced in our brains when we're seeing, for example, something dangerous. Imagine that a poisonous snake would be entering this room here. A lot of us, I can say all of us with that kind of threat, all of us would first go through a sequence where brains produce, after perceiving the snake, they're producing a readiness signal, which basically puts our body on alert a significant number of microseconds before we're actually thinking consciously, oh my God, there's a snake, it's dangerous, I have to run, and I'm moving out of the room. So what you're doing with these systems is that you're exploiting the earliness of this readiness signal, which is an unconscious signal. And now you see where I'm getting at. Because the signal is unconscious, all you want that person to do is to emit that signal and to send it into the computer, which decides on the deployment of the weapon, on the fires, for example. Why do you want to do it? Because you are winning time. What you can do, if you multiply this arrangement, you can scan a lot of enemy territory for targets of any kind, and you can engage those targets, as the term has it, before they have vanished or before they have moved on, because you have a setup which allows you to minimalize the time taken between sighting, the visual perception, and the actual processing. What is gone here? Well, actually, the process of recognition. So the time you save is bought at the price of making conscious the choices you're making when you're actually engaging a target here. So, and I think I'll save you the details of how many milliseconds we are faster than computers. The thing is that this part, the sighting part, can't be done faster by computers. We, human beings, are still much better at visual processing than what computers are. And that's the point of are setting up those so-called brain-machine interfaces. That's why there would be a military interest in having them, because there's still an advantage of the human over the computer. Now, what you see in the latest DARPA projects are projects trying to understand what is happening here and here upon sighting, and to try to copy those processes to be able to digitalize them, basically, to be able to program a computer along them. So the question of visual perception by machines is a big question for the military. But they're not there yet. But on this technology, there has been some leeway made. Now, I will call neuroweapons those weapon systems eliminating the element of human consciousness before engaging a target. And now you are with me when it comes to the overall thrust of my speech. And I think most of you will have thought about the question whether it is the human or the machine that decides on engaging the target in the three scenarios. Now, quite obviously, in the first scenario, it is the human. In the second, it is the machine, the system which gives the signal to the decoys, unless you say some human being must have decided that we're going to have that kind of system mounted on an aircraft with all the kind of advantages and risks that implies. So you're interested in some kind of a command responsibility here. Now, obviously, with command responsibility, you can also address that kind of system, the brain-machine interface weapon system. But I would like us not to do that for the moment, because I think if we resort to command responsibility too quickly, we're going to lose out some important observations on the relatedness of that system to the human. The question of, for example, of the role played by this person whose neural impulses are actually siphoned off. It's quite the opposite person to Leif, isn't it? Leif has received electricity. Here you're taking electricity from a person in order to do things outside that person. All right. Yes, and of course I should give you the acronym at the very least. BMI is the acronym, Brain Machine Interface. That's what we're talking about. So when I'm referring to BMI, it is this what I'm referring to. Now, you could start to ask questions from those three scenarios, especially with a view to the third. They're confronting us with questions, or rather with assumptions about mind and body. Are mind and body two separate entities, or is one to be explained through the other? If so, is it the mind or the body that is, so to say, calling the shots? Or is it a particular, to be specified, combination of both? Do we need a godlike entity to make our assumptions into a comprehensive explanation? That's also questions. Now, these questions are already asked by the philosophy of mind when discussing the mind-body problem, so they're well known. I'm afraid this is no philosophical sideshow in this topic. I'm afraid it's pretty central, because ultimately the discussions on the mind-body problem are about what it means to be human. And you could say that the discussions on international humanitarian law, parts of the laws of war, is about what it means to be human. So there's a convergence here between philosophy when discussing the mind-body problem and hard-nosed law when discussing the legality of engaging certain targets. Both are about our assumptions of what it means to be human. Now, I think the task we have, and I think it's an individual task, it's upon each of us, it can't be delegated, is to think about the meaning of being human, and being cognizant of neurotransmitters and their work in our brain is only one preliminary aspect of that work of recognition of the human. Now, let me put some emphasis on international humanitarian law in the third step of my talk. International humanitarian law, parts of the law of war, parts of international law at large, has a bearing on the choice of targets and the way they are engaged For all the three scenarios I named, they are relevant IHL rules. They are the same. They can be cooked down to two for the purposes of this talk. First is the rule of distinction. We do that. Distinction. Oops, I'm sorry. I can run the quote for you. It's a very simple rule. I'm quoting from a treaty law instrument, Additional Protocol 1 to the Geneva Conventions, Article 48. The parties to a conflict, and I quote, shall at all times distinguish between the civilian population and combatants and between civilian objects and military objectives, and accordingly direct their operations only against military objectives. So it's pivoting on civil military dichotomy here, the rule of distinction. Now, secondly, we have what is called the principle of proportionality. Even here, I'll run a quote. It's taken from the our customary international humanitarian law study commissioned by the International Committee of the Red Cross, published in 2005. The principle of proportionality is expressed as follows in there. Launching an attack, and I quote, launching an attack that may be expected to cause incidental loss of civilian life, injury to civilians, damage to civilian objects, or a combination thereof, which would be excessive in relation to the concrete and direct military advantage anticipated, is prohibited. So here you have a relation between the civil and the military, which is a relation of excess. Now, how does international humanitarian law, IHL, here's the abbreviation, IHL, this is what I'm talking about when I'm referring to law, the second term in the title of my talk. How does IHL relate to neuroweapons? We can say that there are a number of texts on neuroscience and the law, especially in a non-military context, writings on the relation of neuroscience to international humanitarian law are actually scant. Having said that, a great text is Stephen E. White's 2008 note entitled Brave New World, Neurowarfare and the Limits of International Humanitarian Law. And very quickly, the cadence of arguments emerging from White's note is as follows. First, new technology seems to withstand the challenges of illegality under international humanitarian law, he says. I'm not buying this argument because I think he gives the wrong reasons, but that's not important for our talk. Secondly, potential war crimes committed with brain-machine interfaced weapon systems will be impossible to prosecute due to the mens rea requirement. The requirement of willful killing. Can we really talk about the expression of that person's will in a killing effectuated by a brain-machine interface? That's obviously a problem, and I fully agree on his analysis on this point. And thirdly, White says, impunity should be avoided by drawing on command responsibility for both military superiors and, this is a beautiful move, for the developers of weapon systems. He has this wonderful example about Werner von Braun, who should have probably been prosecuted once upon a time and was not, rather he was celebrated in the US, so fine. That's a good way of pointing to the political urgency of that problem, but technically I can't accept that either for reasons I'll explain in a minute. What I really miss in White's great article is a question that could be formulated like that. Is the operator of a brain-machine interfaced weapon system capable of applying international humanitarian law? So I would like to go back a step and not ask, can we prosecute that person successfully, or whomever person actually, but I would first like to confront us the question, whether the person in the first place is capable of applying international humanitarian law. And here we're really back in the mind-body problem, aren't we? Here we really bark in our deeply held beliefs of whether a person whose signals are taken by a weapon system, whether that person is exercising so much of his or her personhood so as to be liable under criminal law, for example. So, now, I saw two possible responses or paths in searching responses to that question of application. And I think for reasons of time, I'll skip the complication of command responsibility and merely point you to the fact that this person might not be the operator at all. This person might just be a cog in the machinery of BMI. So what we are talking about when we're talking about the superior of that person might actually be the operator. So the whole idea of command responsibility that is premised on the existence of a subordinate is actually faltering here, because that person is not a subordinate. It's part, this is one view, it's part of the machinery. Okay, let me get back to the question. Now it's no longer a question for Stephen White, who is, of course, fully legitimate in not answering a question he hasn't asked himself, but a question for me and for us: is a state capable of applying international humanitarian law when employing a future brain-machine interfaced weapons system? Two different paths. Here's the first path. When you ask experts to explain what is the difference between a human being and a computer, you tend to get answers which are emphasizing that the computer is usually good at calculating and at applying logic, whereas the human being is good at imagining and reasoning, whatever reasoning might mean. Now, if you go back to the norm, to the principle of proportionality, you would actually agree with me that both the qualities of being able to imagine and the quality of being able to reason are important ones. You are, before making the decision on the launch of an attack, you are imagining what will the outcome be. What will happen if I activate that weapon? Will there be disproportional consequences? What will the consequences be in the first place? And that's all the more true because the way the principle of proportionality is formulated, it asks lawyers to do some kind of a reasoning with incommensurable values, those of civilian loss on one hand and on military advantage on the other. Those are not easily reconciled, on the face of it at least. So you indeed have to do reasoning in the sense that you add criteria to the setup. You have to build up something in order to make to draw a conclusion out of the task you're confronted with. So I think that is one argument why there is a place for particular human rationality in answering the question: can a BMI really apply international humanitarian law? Well, if it is so that the human qualities, the particular human qualities, are imagination and reasoning, and part of IHL is applying the principle of proportionality, well, then the answer would be no. Probably a machine cannot apply international humanitarian law. And when you have a brain-machine interface, what you have is a dominance of the machine. So here we are. The answer is no. Now, that can be extended by looking at the human input into a brain-machine interfaced weapon system, which will be at the subconscious level if it is to outperform enemy systems relying on human consciousness. It is prima facie hard to fathom how imagination and reasoning needed to apply IHL could be located at the subconscious level and operate with the requisite speed. So here the idea is, could we really press this down into some kind of a military intuition? Probably we can't until we are prepared to lose out on IHL. So to claim that there can be speedy unconscious cognition of threats is one thing, but to claim that there can be speedy unconscious recognition of a legitimate target is quite another. And therefore, I would argue along this path that IHL cannot be applied by operators of brain-machine interfaced weapon systems. Unless the deploying military takes the time for a human review of all targeting decisions through a superior before the target is engaged. But what you do then is that you are losing time again, because you have to have a human review. And you're back to something which is more akin to scenario one. And that's a very real constraint. We should think about the millions and millions you're investing into research, into BMIs, before you're rolling out the weapons, deploying them in the field. At that point in time, you want the time benefits of that systems to be reaped. You don't want to go back to a situation that you had when deploying much cheaper, older technology. Now, you could go further and give this understanding some traction in Western traditions of thought by drawing on the mythical narrative of the Golem of Prague. And now I'm shifting focus a bit here, but I think that might come well in. You might be aware of the Golem figure. So I should write that up too, the Golem. It is a narrative. This is something which is, it is a myth. And it is about a figure of which is manufactured by man and combines the capabilities of a human, or it combines human and superhuman features, I should say. In that particular case, Rabbi Löw of Prague was said to have created the golem with its superior strength in order to defend the Prague Jewry from the risks of impeding pogroms. Certain renderings of the myth cast the golem as incapable of speaking. This is strangely echoing the side effects of treating Parkinson's disease by deep brain stimulation. By and by, the golem proved incapable of observing the foundational norms of its mission to defend the Jewish inhabitants threatened by anti-Semitic violence and prey. And the golem turned violent against those whom it was set to protect. In that narrative, the capability to observe the law of self-defense, as it were, in this case, is at least weakly linked to language. With more autonomy allocated by Rabbi Löw to the golem, it seems that the golem will be less able to apply the law, namely the foundational norms, its mission statement, one could say. Let that rest, and follow me now onto the second opposed path. Let me illustrate another take at the mind-body problem after having acted out a take emphasizing the role of language, the role of consciousness. Here is the introduction to an article called Law and the Revolution in Neuroscience, an early look at the field by a professor at Stanford Law School, Henry T. Greeley. And I quote, I can't resist the quote, it's so wonderful. And I quote, "Everything that you just perceived, saw, heard, felt, or contemplated, as far as we can tell, is all about neurons giving up and taking up neurotransmitters. And that's it. The entire universe that exists within reach of our skulls seems to be the product of these electrochemical reactions. That's all. It is a daunting vision, and one that has taken me a long time to accept, but I've ultimately become convinced of the truth. Largely because there doesn't seem to be any place for anything else to be. Certainly modern neuroscience works on the premise that our minds, our thoughts, our perceptions, our emotions, our beliefs, our actions are all generated by our brains, by the roughly 100 billion physical neurons and their several hundred connections or synapses per neuron." You would like to have this kind of deep voice in order to intonate that quote. End of quote, by the way. Now, Greeley surely caricatures the richness and indeterminacy of the debate on the significance of neuroscience, but the introduction is beautiful in the way it squarely, perhaps naively so, begs the question of the place of language, and in extension also of the place of the law. If all we have is the firing of neurons and neuronal networks, who could point out a place where law is in its own and from which it can be applied. Now, this made me think about the elective affinity between Greeley's purportedly mainstream view of the human and that of transhumanist fringe thinkers who are discussing the uploading of human consciousness onto a computer. Now, you might think this sounds weird or like some kind of a bad Hollywood production. No, this is a discussion which has been ongoing, and this is interesting at least as long as we have seen the development of this type of weapons. So if anybody associates to science fiction, or as I said, fringe discussions in scholarship, you are absolutely not mistaken. There's a strange kind of interplay between various arenas for intellectual activities. Now, what these people, the transhumanists, do, they're thinking of the uploading of human consciousness onto a computer in order to achieve immortality. Our consciousness can then move from computer system to computer system. To the extent those signals, the neurotransmitter signals, which really emphasizes all there is, to the extent they can be mapped and binarized and coded, the distance between a mainstream law professor of the Greeley type and a fringe transhumanist suddenly decreases dramatically. Now, if we were to believe with Professor Greeley that electrochemical reactions are giving a full causal explanation of what is happening in our brains, it should be good news that neuroscience is increasingly able to map them. Consider the following projection, which is entirely of my own making. We repeatedly assemble a large group of IHL experts from all continents with a superior track record in the practical application of international humanitarian law, and in particular targeting norms. We link them up to EEGs, to functional MRIs, and what other medical technology there is for scanning electrical impulses and brain activities. And we're confronting them with a large number of audiovisual targeting simulations in which they have to apply IHL to a specific weapon system. Obviously, you record that. We do the same mapping and recording exercise on a non-expert group, which knows nothing about IHL, and we're comparing the two data sets. Now, ideally, we should know what makes IHL tick, and it's based on an empirical observation at the very source which Greeley points out, namely the neurological processes in the brain. So if you're going empirical here, and if you hold the same beliefs as Greeley does, you really have a source of law to speak about. Now we know how IHL is working in a sense. So, returning to my question whether a state employing a brain-machine interface weapon system would be capable of applying IHL, my invention would allow the answer, yes, why not? And why should we not adopt such a system? What would be lost? In asking that, I want to challenge myself on the possibility that there be a place for language, politics, and the law. And I should perhaps add that I'm not serious in proposing this. I'm serious in the sense that I'm serious about the challenge, but I'm not thinking that this is the way to implement IHL. That as an aside. Now, I'm rounding off my talk with a couple of comments, final comments on the question of whether there is some kind of a natural law of destruction we will be approaching if we go down the brain-machine interfaced road. Now, in earlier research, I encountered considerable formal difficulties when trying to understand how the IHL principle of proportionality is to be applied, given that it relates two incommensurable entities to each other, civilian loss and military advantage. I could resolve these difficulties only by introducing a widespread Clausewitzian conception of the purpose of war as a civil political objective. Now, what does Clausewitz say? He held that wars are fought to compel the enemy to fulfill the victor's will, to fulfill our will, if we put ourselves into the victor's shoes. This civil political objective would be commensurable to the military objective pursued by single targeting decisions as well as by strategic warfare at large. If the extent of civilian casualties block requisite change in the will of the enemy, they're militarily disadvantaged and therefore prohibited. A lesser extent of civilian casualties is not. It's also permitted under international humanitarian law. Now, that doesn't put IHL in a very favorable lighting, but that's the sense I could make of it until now. Until this has been disproven by our ongoing empirical study on targeting, which Christina already named, I will assume some kind of a Hegelian stance on targeting norms in IHL, namely that they reflect an attempt to embody the objective spirit of the state. What does that mean? And in order to that explain that, I'm not going to Hegel himself, but I'm going to the 2010 Tactical Directive for the Prevention of Civilian Casualties issued by the then commander of US forces in Afghanistan, General David Petraeus, which starts with the following sentence: "We must never forget that the center of gravity in the struggle is the Afghan people. It is they who will ultimately determine the future of Afghanistan." And then it continues: "Prior to the use of fires, the commander approving the strike must determine that there are no civilians present, etc., etc." But it starts with this emphasis on the self-determination of the people of Afghanistan. Now, what is the purpose of this particular feathering of violence? I think that Clausewitz, international humanitarian law, and Petraeus here, they chime into each other on the necessity to preserve so much willpower with the enemy so as to enable the enemy to fulfill the will of the victor as its own. Historically, since a fair number of years now, sheer subjugation of the enemy no longer seems to be an option. And in political thought, this trope has a longer history. It precedes the French Revolution. It goes back beyond Clausewitz to Samuel Pufendorf. In his The Whole Duty of Man, there's a chapter of war and peace. It is set in the context of interstate wars in Europe. In that chapter, the enemy is cast as a justa hostis, a just enemy, an equal in a sense. And wars against it will be brought to end by a peace treaty or by conquest rather than by annihilation. Both forms of termination of conflict pivot on the preservation of the enemy's will and the enemy's willpower to accept a peace treaty or a conquest. Petraeus' directive is good at illustrating that aspect of justus hostis thinking, pointing out that the Afghan people's determination of its own future is a center of gravity for the war-fighting effort. By preserving the civilian, a people is preserved. By preserving a people, the forum for the future of the human will formation is preserved. Now, my point is that this tradition is endangered if we move into an ontology based on, an ontology on which brain-machine interfaces are based. Neural weapons are placing us outside the trajectory of Pufendorf, Clausewitz, and Hegel in a number of respects. They're thinning out our linkages between the conduct of warfare and the political will of the peoples conducting it on both sides. The temporal logic of neural weapons reduces contact with human consciousness. The human integrated into neural weapons is merely a supplier of neurological signals, thus no operator at all. And the superior supervising the deployment of neural weapons is a true operator and already at a considerable temporal and phenomenological distance to the combat situation into which the weapon is about to intervene. That superior operator is doubly burdened, first with the assumption that the brain-machine interfaced weapon delivers a description of reality that is vouchsafed for by the natural sciences, and second, with the awareness that her conscious recognition efforts retard the temporal competitiveness of the system. Compare this to the reverse temporal sequence expressed in Petraeus' directive, where the being there of civilians is a first consideration, whatever we might say about Petraeus and the war in Afghanistan otherwise. As a military using neural weapons needs to be comparatively less in touch with its own consciousness when using neural weapons, there will be far less persons spending far less time with thinking about the preservation of political will formation of their adversaries. The people whose determination of their own future is purportedly at the center of the war effort. Such thinking is no longer a dominant trope in a neuroscience of war. What takes center stage in neuroscientific warfare is a different form of normativity, sourced in firing neuronal networks responding to what is cast and made perceivable as the laws of nature. Pufendorf's project was a secular natural law, overcoming the annihilation tendencies of European religious conflict. Neuroweapons empirically determine a question that Pufendorf sought to neutralize, namely the question on the precise criterion for ultimate normativity. Therefore, whatever its selling points on increased accuracy and surgicality may be, I fear that neuroscience of war will prove to be deeply anti-secular. Its wars will not result in peace treaties or oaths of fidelity to the conqueror, but in the administration of occupation. And, borrowing a term from Vigge Sebald, a German writer, the violence devised by it will make itself intelligible only as a natural history of destruction.